Israeli troops now operating inside war-torn Gaza, with Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu again rejecting calls for a ceasefire. Meanwhile, 40 more Filipinos have managed to flee the violence in Gaza. Two key allies of former President Rodrigo Duterte, former President Gloria Arroyo, and Davao Representative Isidro Ungab, replaced as House Deputy Speakers, will tackle Duterte's beef with the lower chamber as well as some recent resignations in his PDP Laban Party with Party President Congressman Jose Alvarez. And more Filipinos went jobless in September. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Our top story at this hour. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says Israeli forces are now operating inside Gaza City as they press on with a month-long offensive against Hamas. In a televised statement, Netanyahu said there will be no ceasefire or fuel delivery to Gaza without the release of hostages. He also warned Hezbollah against joining Hamas in the war. Meanwhile, Israel's defense minister says the country has no plans to rule Gaza once the war is over.
For me, this mission cannot be stopped until its achievements are reached. This war, which we were forced into, we won't go back nor stop. There is only going forward until Hamas is defeated and the hostages are returned. I can tell you who will not govern. It will not be Hamas, and it will not be Israel. Everything else is a possibility. And I want to say one more thing. At the end of this conflict, there will be no Hamas in Gaza.
A doctor at Gaza's Al-Shifa Hospital says Israeli attacks were getting closer to the complex every day. Israel has claimed Hamas is hiding tunnel entrances and operational centers inside Al-Shifa. The group has denied this. Doctors also insist only civilians are in hospital grounds.
The current situation is really getting tighter and tighter. So what we have been experiencing for the last month is that we feel they are coming closer to Shifa Hospital. And it's more of that we had many nights where they were bombing a lot of the neighborhoods near the hospital. The hospitals are usually protected by the international law, especially that we don't have military groups in Gaza, like obvious on the ground. You don't see anyone carrying a gun or weapon in the middle of Gaza. They might be there near the borders, but there is nothing like they can attack or military camp or something. So all the people here are civilians.
Gaza's main hospital has turned into a giant refuge for civilians whose homes have been bombarded. So far, over 10,000 Palestinians, including thousands of children, have been killed in the war. A United Nations agency says services in Gaza are close to breaking point without fuel supply. The UN Humanitarian Office says none of the nearly 600 aid trucks that reached the enclave so far were carrying fuel. The World Health Organization also appealing for the delivery of fuel to hospitals.
We're coming close to half of the available hospitals. As you've seen the reports, Al-Shifa Hospital reported that the solar panels on their roof had been struck too. That means the only remaining electricity source they had gone. Other hospitals have reported similar situations. So you ask, I think, when will we start to be critical or something like this? When will this start to be an issue? We're in the middle of it. More and more facilities are closing down, and more life-saving means are closing down.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says 40 more Filipinos have successfully exited Gaza. In a video message, Marcos said they are now on their way to Cairo in Egypt and will be returning to the Philippines in the next few days.
Nagpapasalamat din tayo sa mga pamahalaan ng Israel at Egypt sa kanilang pagbibigay prioridad sa ating mga kababayan upang makalabas ng kanilang teritoryo. Kinikilala din natin ang mediation effort ng Qatar. Umaasa ako na yung natitirang kababayan na nagnanais ding makauwi, makakatawid na ng maayos kasama ang kanilang mga asawa at mahal sa buhay.
Four Filipinos have been killed in the Israel-Hamas war, with two others still unaccounted for. In other news, it's been 10 years since one of the most powerful storms in modern history struck the Philippines. Thousands of lives cut short, bustling cities left in ruins when Super Typhoon Yolanda hit. To commemorate the tragedy, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. visited Tacloban as the city tells the story of both pain and resilience 10 years on. Our very own Joyce Balancho now joins us with more on this. Joyce, over to you.
Yes, Carmina, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. this morning led the program for the commemoration of the 10th year since the Super Typhoon Yolanda hit Tacloban City in the province of Leyte. The event here at the Tacloban City Convention Center started with a mass. President Marcos, in his message, emphasized how grateful the country is to those who have helped in the recovery of the city. He specifically recognized the members of the diplomatic corps and the representatives from different local and international non-government organizations who were present in the event. Marcos also recounted his experience when he personally came to the city and stayed for days to help in addressing the damages as well as countless deaths after the typhoon ravaged the Leyte province.
10 years have gone by, and yet the memory of this tragedy remains indelible in our hearts and in our thoughts. To this day, we still do not know the true scope of our loss. Because we grieve and we mourn those of our dead. But we must always keep a special place in our hearts for those who we lost, who are uncounted, who are unrecorded. So that up to now, we say 6,000 casualties. We do not know that for sure. To the survivors who continue to move forward, we salute your indomitable spirit and character.
Remembering Yolanda, Marcos said it is crucial that the government prioritizes measures to address climate change in its national policies to ensure also that the repeat of the tragedy will be avoided. Disaster resilient evacuations are being put up, Marcos said, while early warning systems and incident command systems are being procured by the administration. He also ordered the Department of Human Settlements and Urban Development to accelerate the giving of land titles and housing units to the residents of Tacloban City. He also urged the Yolanda Response Cluster to work closely with the national government agencies to address lingering issues and provide the residents with necessary assistance so they can rebuild their lives. Before the event ended, Marcos led the ceremonial distribution of certificates of awards to some housing beneficiaries. After that, he proceeded to the opening ceremony of the 2023 Handa Pilipinas Visayas Leg, organized by the Department of Science and Technology, still here in Tacloban City. This annual event aims to raise public awareness and adoption of available technological innovations related to disaster risk reduction and management. In his message, Marcos encouraged the use of these innovations so that the country will be better equipped against the impacts of calamities and disasters. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Joyce Balancho there joining us on the line. And back here in the newsroom, Tacloban City's economic recovery continues a decade after that deadly typhoon. The city's mayor, Alfred Romualdez, says they're now back on track as more businesses have already recovered from the calamity. He adds more jobs and opportunities have opened in the region.
We've not only recovered, but we've grown, I would say, about 300% to 400% more. We base it on the VAT contribution that every sale that is made in our city contributed to the national government, and that has almost tripled. And to see that our contribution to the national government is far much more now. Business opportunities are much, much more now. We are much, much better than before. I would say it was like what you would describe as one step backwards and two steps forward.
The commemoration of the deadly typhoon has renewed calls for climate justice. Dozens of Yolanda survivors and environmental advocates from Manila arrived in Tacloban Tuesday after walking for a month to raise awareness on the worsening effects of climate change. The group now pressing world leaders to take urgent action to address the climate crisis.
Justice, in its essence, is about fairness. And the climate change crisis, which result in so much devastation and loss of lives, loss of livelihoods. This is a problem which countries like the Philippines contributed very little to. But industrialized nations, rich countries who have benefited from using up the atmospheric space, as we call it, which has led to climate change. They remain unaccountable. They refuse to take urgent and ambitious concrete actions to solve this problem. There is no existing climate justice fund, but in the UN Conference of Parties last year in Egypt, we managed to establish a loss and damage fund, which is almost equivalent to a climate justice fund. It has already been established, but it's empty.
A power shift in the House of Representatives. Former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo removed as Deputy Speaker after failing to sign a resolution upholding the integrity of the lower chamber, RJ Cruz reports.
Speaker, I move to elect Representative Antonio Tonipet Albano as Deputy Speaker, Vice Representative Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. I move to elect Representative Yasser Alonto Balindong as Deputy Speaker, Vice Representative Isidro Ungab.
Is there any objection? The Chair hears none. The motion is approved. Majority Leader.
No one objected when the majority moved to replace two key allies of former President Rodrigo Duterte and Vice President Sara Duterte. Former President and Pampanga Representative Gloria Arroyo and Davao City Representative Isidro Ungab as Deputy Speakers, with Isabela Representative Antonio Albano and Lanao del Sur Representative Yasser Balindong. In a statement, Majority Leader Manuel Jose de Lipe explained this was because the two lawmakers refused to sign a resolution which the leadership pushed. House lawmakers spent the better part of their first session after more than a one-month-long break approving House Resolution 1414, upholding the integrity and dignity of the House and the speakership of Martin Romualdez. This almost a month after former President Rodrigo Duterte in a TV interview slammed the House for taking away the confidential funds of his daughter. The resolution named no one and only referred to the House objecting to any attacks on its integrity, dignity, and independence, as well as threats to its members. If not for Albay Representative Edsel Lagman's questions, the principal sponsor of the measure, Senior Deputy Speaker Aurelio Dong Gonzalez, would not admit who really is the reason for the resolution, but not before signing on the spot. Gonzalez is a member of the PDP Laban, which Duterte chairs. On Facebook, the former president explained the importance of standing by principles and how he won't countenance setting aside principles for convenience. Leaders of other parties backed the resolution, including other members of PDP Laban. De Lipe said that lawmakers have the obligation to make sure political power is not abused. De Lipe explained the resolution was too important as it was in defense of the institution. While they respect dissent, De Lipe says the leadership feels it is important to be united amidst challenges and to be of the same mind as the leadership. De Lipe said that by refusing to sign, the two show disagreement with the leadership when the leadership feels it is better off being with those of the same mind. Ungab, meantime, accepted his fate, saying he had no bitterness or rancor, as he thanked his supporters and affirmed his support for the administration. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Meanwhile, former President Gloria Arroyo says there is not much she can do if the House leadership does not believe she is not plotting to unseat Speaker Romualdez. In a statement, Arroyo said there will always be intrigue in politics. The former president adds she no longer aspires to become Speaker of the House. Despite the intrigue, Arroyo reaffirmed her support for both Speaker Romualdez and President Marcos. All about solidarity and not politicking. That's how Surigao del Sur Representative Johnny Pimentel described the power shift in Congress. He says the removal of Arroyo and Ungab as deputy speakers has nothing to do with the realignment of Vice President Sara Duterte's confidential funds. Pimentel adds the latest move in the lower house is not a preview of the 2028 elections?
The political dynamics in Congress is quite different from other political institutions. It's a collegial body. Every decision that we make has to be decided by the majority. If you are against the direction of the leadership, then you are not part of the leadership. It's not in any way related to the political aspirations of any political person in 2028. Malayo pa yung 2028. Oh, so it's just that we have to react.
As for the resolution upholding the integrity of Congress following former President Duterte's attacks, Pimentel says it's the duty of lawmakers to protect the institution. Pimentel is BDP Laban's vice president for Mindanao. Duterte sits as the chairman of the once ruling party.
You have already probably heard the word rotten, which I think Congress will not take it sitting down, no? I think we have to defend. It's very clear in the Constitution, in the resolution. We also have to defend one of our members who have been threatened by a person publicly. So I think we are in the right direction.
Another ally of former President Duterte shrugging off the ongoing political drama in the House of Representatives. Senator Ronald De La Rosa insists Duterte has his own opinions and that should be respected. De La Rosa also dismissing allegations of a planned coup against President Marcos.
Wala kaming pakialam sa resolution nila. We exercise and we observe interparliamentary courtesy. They are free to do what they want to do. Kami rin, meron kami decision dito. Meron respeto rin naman nila. So, gano'n lang yun. Basta importante ha, wala akong na-monitor na destabilization report. At ako, kung meron man, I will not take part. Kung meron mo nagpaplano dyan ng mga retired generals, I am advising you openly na please, don't do it. Kung mayroon man nagpa-plano. Pero as far as I know, alam ko wala nagpa-plano. Wala nagpa-plano. Alam sa kaalaman ko lang. Pero kung mayroon man, just in case, huwag yung gawin niyan. At maglaban-laban tayo dito. Diba? Pwede pong pwede magandang magiging resort tayo.
Well, aside from former President Duterte's verbal assault on the lower house, his party, the PDP Laban, also dealing with the resignation of its Secretary General, Melvin Matibag, as well as Senior Deputy Speaker Aurelio Gonzalez. Let's take a look back at how Gonzalez announced his resignation.
I also would feel bad hearing that accusation that the house is rotten. But may we know? Who uttered that statement? Was it a comic or a leader or previous leader of this country? Why is the name of that accuser so sacrosanct that we cannot mention it before this body?
Mr. Chairman, I will answer the question of Congressman Opalbay, Congressman Echelagman. But before I will answer your question, Mr. President of the PDP party, are you here? Mr. President, Congressman Alvarez, the one who uttered that word is our chairman from PDP Laban. Before I will answer, I will resign now as member and officer of PDP Laban, the former President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, the one who said that, Mr. Chairman.
Well, joining us now, the president of PDP Laban, Palawan Representative Jose Alvarez. Congressman Alvarez, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina.
All right, I don't know if you just heard, but we played back to our viewers what happened on the floor a few days back. Aurelio Gonzalez resigning from PDP Laban, mentioning your name as well. Did you know that that was going to go down when it happened? Congressman?
No, it was not. He was not resigning immediately. He just submitted his resignation and just received it today. That is just a verbal announcement that before he can answer the Honorable Edsel Lagman from Albay, he just wanted to personally say that he would vacate his post in the PDP Laban and as member also of PDP Laban, because he did not want to mention the name of President Duterte while being the treasurer and as member of the PDP Laban. So that was very gentlemanly of him. I admire him for that.
Did you know, though, that he was going to do that before he did it?
We expected some resignation since last week. And, of course, on intimate basis, I know that he was also going to another party. Even before last Monday's Committee of the Whole gathering in the plenary.
So you just said that you expected some resignation since last week. Do we take that to mean that many more will follow suit? That Matibag, Gonzalez, they're not the last to resign from PDP Laban?
About Melvin Matibag, it's just his personal move, because his wife earlier joined the Lakas party and taking oath, I think, late last month. And it's already a foregone conclusion that he will also follow suit. But on the case of Senior Deputy Speaker Don Gonzalez from Pampanga, I can expect that before he would want to answer the interpellation of our Honorable Edsel Lagman from Albay, he would say something to that effect.
Mm-hmm. Is Congressman Gonzalez also going to Lakas?
Presumably. We have not spoken about where he is going.
But you said a while ago that you think that he was going to move to another party.
Of the House of Representatives. And he's one of the leaders here that replaced the senior deputy speaker, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. So I would suppose that he might join Lakas.
You said a while ago that you expected some resignations since last week. Why were you expecting this? What gave you reason to expect?
Because, as usual, in the politics of our country, I just came from a hearing this morning about the new Department of Fishery and Aquatic Resources, and I explained there that, of course, the fish will go to the corals, where the corals are natural habitat of the fishes. So, that is just a parallelism that I could say as of now. But no offense meant to our colleagues. They are free to move about between parties.
What do you mean by that? The corals have the power, the corals have the money, the corals are able to give the fish what the fish need?
You're saying that. I am not saying that.
No, I'm just clarifying if that's what you meant.
You're saying that, so I'm not saying that.
Is that what you meant?
You're saying that. I didn't say that.
Congressman Alvarez, do you think that politics had or has everything to do with the shifts, with the power shift that we're seeing at the lower house? And this all points to 2025 and 2028.
There's some semblance to it. I suppose that members of the House will be positioning themselves in order to be of use to any party that will be contending the 2025 election. So more so on the 2028.
Mm-hmm. And have you spoken to the former president since all this transpired?
not yet. Yesterday, I went out of the chamber as early as 4 o'clock, excuse myself, mm-hmm. for another meeting in Makati. Mm-hmm. And I just heard the news late about 8 o'clock in the afternoon that Deputy Speaker Ongab was also removed, so as with Deputy Speaker, former President Gloria Arroyo. Mm-hmm. So you can assume that there was some positioning already.
Mm-hmm. Do the cracks in the party, how is that going to affect the overall health of PDP Laban?
Well, we're still the majority party considered by Comelec, because it's not only the congressmen in the House that are members of the party. We have so many members in the local electoral process, in the LGUs and in the cities and in the towns. But we are a member of the ruling coalition here in the House. That's why the expression of Resolution 1414 was the collective decision of the majority of the congressmen. So mm-hmm. therefore, we are also supporting that Resolution 1414 just to protect the institution, nothing personal.
Mm. And tell me about that and the decision process that you had to make. Was that even hard for you, considering that, considering the loyalty to the former president, the loyalty to PDP Laban, and the loyalty to the institution?
There is no speaking of loyalty as far as Resolution 1414, because it was a collective decision of the whole House, of which we a majority in the PDP Laban just expressed our... It was just a sentiment. Mm.
It was a sentiment that had to be expressed because of the attacks that came from the party president, or from the former president. Go ahead.
Expressed in writing by the committee as a whole that was convened last Monday.
Yeah. No, but where does that put you specifically? Let's talk about you, because you signed that resolution as well, and you are a high-ranking official.
Assume that I signed the resolution. Oh. There is no need for us to sign resolution. Even Deputy Speaker Arroyo and Deputy Speaker Ongab need not sign that resolution if they wanted to support resolution.
Mm. But you believe in the resolution. You need not sign it, but you believe in the value of that resolution.
Well, as expressed in that resolution, you can contemplate and you can deduce from the contents of that resolution that that is the majority decision of the members of the House.
Mm-hmm. How do you explain that then to the former president, given that the attacks came from him?
Well, that is expected. One attack from one sector and an attack from another would just create a counter reply. As the speaker has mentioned, nothing personal about it.
Congressman, you said that you still believe that you're the ruling party for now. Do you think that's going to hold?
I did not say we are the ruling party. We are not in power. Mm. I just said we are the majority party still considered by Comelec. So just two different things. We are not the ruling, but we are the majority party. And in Congress, we are the member of the ruling coalition.
There you go. Do you think
majority coalition in Congress? We are members.
Do you think that that's going to hold? Because as you described a while ago, it's not just in the lower house. You have other members as well to speak of in other positions in the bureaucracy, in elected positions. Do you think that's going to hold given the resignations of late?
Oh yes, we as a party can still hold on to it. And we're not expecting that we will be superior in numbers, but we can still be a member of the majority coalition.
And there lies the problem right there. Do you think that what has happened in the last few days really shows the weakness of what we have, a multi-party system where, you know, members can come and go as they please, Congressman?
That has been the subject matter of so much discussion, torn quotation. But as expected, before a definitive law could be passed against torn quotation, expect that to happen every now and then, that there's a change in leadership.
Mm. And how's that serving the country any good?
Well, if you ask me, it's not just to maintain their stature in the hierarchy of parties, but first and foremost is, of course, to protect their individual interest in their respective districts or their respective LGUs or respective regions. Mm-hmm. So that's the purpose of the affiliation to the parties. But as for those who are remaining in PDP, we can remain here and just perform our job as called for us here in the Congress or in the LGUs or province or the cities that these members of PDP are located. It does not mean that just because there is a political division happening in the Congress, everyone in the country will be affected. I think as PDP, we can still maintain ourselves.
Are you going to remain with the PDP Laban, Congressman?
Yes, of course.
We're not going to hear a resignation from you in the months leading to 2025 or maybe 2028?
Oh, definitely not.
You're there to stay.
Definitely. I was asked to give this party, not on my own volition, but I was requested to head this party in order to form this party so that the next younger set of generation can use this party in the future.
Mm-hmm.
That is my objective here, and knowing that, I will concentrate on that, and regardless of what's going to happen in the 2025 and 2028, maybe I'm no longer there by reason of age, because I'm now 79 years old. But for as long as I can do some service to the party as I was requested, I will do it for the unity and for the existence of this party.
Finally, Congressman, if I were to ask you now, what is the true state of your party, how would you answer?
Well, we're still existing and we're still surviving, and there is no reason for the party to disintegrate.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Jose Alvarez there, president of PDP Laban. Thanks again for taking our call.
Thank you for taking me, Carmina.
All right, from there, we're going to take a quick break. Up ahead, the unemployment rate in the Philippines rises in September with 2.26 million jobless Filipinos. Details of that story and more when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC. Philippine authorities follow fresh leads in the killing of Misamis Occidental radio man Juan Homalon. We have this report.
Authorities in northern Mindanao say they are putting up more checkpoints amid follow-up operations regarding the killing of broadcaster Juan Humalon last Sunday. In Calamba, Misamis Occidental, the northern Mindanao police director visited Humalon's wake Tuesday. Brigadier General Ricardo Layog Jr. says police are working on some leads to unmask those behind the killing. Talking to police, Humalon's wife Cheribel disclosed she saw the gunman fleeing after shooting her husband dead inside the booth of his own radio station.
Bumabas din ako. Nakita ko yung motor single doon nakapark sa may kanto. Then, yun, sumakay yung dalawang tao. Then, ang sabi ko, police, police, tapang. So, tumingin sila sa akin. Then siguro na natumba silang tatlo.
Humalon's wife on Tuesday said her husband had won a case before his death over a land dispute that sought to take over the lot where their radio station is located. She said the RTC has already ruled in favor of their lawsuit. A separate case has also been filed for the annulment of the title.
Ano sa land po namin, sir, nag-file kami ng criminal case falsification of public documents doon sa MPC Oropita City, sir. Nag-file doon, sir, yung husband po. Kasi po yung lupa namin dito, yung nakapirma ng mga deed of sale ay puro matagal nang namatay, sir.
Brigadier General Layog says investigators were on the trail of some fresh leads a day after they published composite sketches of one of the suspects.
Lahat po nung angulo na nabanggit before, lahat yun na open pa rin po.
According to the police, at least three men directly participated in Humalon's killing, but they were also not discounting more people could have been involved.
May mga nagsabi na magbibigay ng reward. Mangyayari dyan, mas marami po na mga kababayan natin ang magbibigay ng information sa madaling kalutasan nito pong insidente na ito.
Police in nearby provinces have also been put on alert for possible witnesses or information that could lead to the suspects. The Mindanao Independent Press Council, or MIPC, believes the motive behind Humalon's killing is personal, but it calls on the PNP to conduct a thorough probe. Cheribel believes her husband did not offend anyone in his broadcast, which is only meant for entertainment. In the meantime, the Presidential Task Force on Media Security says a 100,000 peso reward has been put up for the arrest of the perpetrators. The PNP, for its part, says one of their priorities remain tracking down the vehicles used by the perpetrators, with police now saying there are indications they could have switched vehicles during their escape. Rafi Santos, ABS-CBN News, Misamis Occidental.
Authorities arrest the leaders of a civic group in Surigao del Norte accused of human trafficking and child abuse, Sherian Torres reports.
The National Bureau of Investigation has arrested the leader of the Socorro Bayanihan Services Incorporated, J. Renz Quilario, and 12 others. This is in connection with trafficking and child abuse charges.
Sir, you have the right to remain silent. You also have the anything you say will be used against you in court of law. You have the right to a lawyer if you cannot appoint one.
Before the arrest, the Senate hearing uncovered more irregularities committed by the group. This is a list of couples who reportedly lost their child while living in Sitio Capihan as members of SBSI. One of them was the baby of Randolph Balbarino, who was born in breech position in 2020 but only lived for 2 days. Balbarino says his wife was already in great pain when village health workers assisting her decided to just pull out their baby.
Wala akong magawa kasi yung asawa ko nagsasabi na wala daw akong tiwala kay Senyor Aguila.
Local officials have a theory why many children died in Sitio Capihan.
Capihan members, wala kaming record na nagpapinital. Yung mga buntis, talagang walang record namin sa RHU, no, na walang nagpapinital, walang nanganak ng health facility. Kasi yung health center, yun yung birthing ng LGU, ang Socorro.
Balbarino says 50% of his income as fisherman automatically goes to SBSI as member donation. But not only that, the Department of Social Welfare and Development says the agency consistently extends assistance to indigent families of Socorro. Around 200 of them are SBSI members.
Simula po ng 2019, nakapagbigay tayo ng educational grants and health grants sa mga beneficiaries including their rice subsidies. At yan po ay naibigay natin sa 202 na household members. Yan po in the form of cash. Yan po ay 600 pesos po kada buwan.
According to the information, dito sa pidabit ng isang membro nila ay binabawasan ng 1,000 na pupunta sa SBSI. But this happened after the fact na. After your distribution, merong umiikot itong si Flor Delis Ilandag na according to Senior Aguila, ay kanilang treasurer. Ito'y nangungulikta at ineskortan pa ng mga Aguila.
The DSWD confirms to have been receiving the same information from SBSI members.
Ang kapihan po ay sila po lahat na consider as totally damaged yung houses nila doon kasi heavily hit sila ng audit. So nakatanggap ang bawat household ng 10,000 po. So, ang narinig ko po na mga na-report po, may nagbigay ng 6,000. Parang may kinolekta na 6,000. May iba din po na 5,000, so 50-50.
Ilyas Chloe, who is now 15 years old, tells the panel she was only 13 when an officer of SBSI, Janet Ahok, locked her in a room with a 21-year-old man who raped her.
Dili na tinuod, sir.
Kung hindi totoo, may panahon po nga pong pinatawag ako, tapos tinanong na kung ano apelyido ko. Tingnan mo nga saan galing yung apelyido mo, tapos ikaw pa yung may karapatang mag-adyos.
Before the hearing ended, Justice Undersecretary Nicolas Felix T. reports to the panel they have filed 20 cases against 13 SBSI officials. These include illegal solemnization of child marriage, child abuse, and the non-bailable qualified trafficking in persons charges. T. says the government is likely to file additional cases against the SBSI.
Clearly, there are other incidents that we can look into, such as the children who died, no, in childbirth, as well as the abuse of the senior citizen who testified earlier.
We invoke on the principle that the rights of the parties cannot be prejudiced by mere allegation. We have our courts of justice.
Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
More Filipinos went jobless in September. Data from the Philippine Statistics Authority show the unemployment rate for that month rose to 4.5%, translating to 2.26 million jobless Filipinos. That's higher than August's 4.4% reading. Meanwhile, the underemployment rate in September eased to 10.7% from 11.7%. Despite the uptick in unemployment figures, an analyst still describes the latest jobs data as encouraging.
The jobs data, we note that of course this is slightly higher than last month's print, but it is actually lower than the 5% recorded in September last year, and actually lower than the average 5.1% inflation rate pre-pandemic, I mean 2019. So in a sense, it's still encouraging. It is also within range.
Taiwanese EV maker Gogoro, now in Manila. Its joint venture partners from the Ayala Group took Filipinos on a test drive of its smart scooters with the opening of its flagship center in Makati. More from Andrea Taguines.
A more eco-friendly and efficient urban commute. That's what Gogoro Philippines, a joint venture among the Taiwanese e-scooter brand, Ayala Corporation, and Globe Telecom's 917 Ventures, promises Filipino customers. As it opened its first international flagship center in Makati City. Gogoro co-founder and CEO Horace Luke says they've long considered entering the Philippine market since many of the country's transportation woes are similar to that of Taiwan.
It desperately needs a solution like this, not only because of pollution, but the Philippines, of course, especially around in Greater Manila, is infamous for traffic jams, right? And the lack of public, you know, very proliferate public transportation makes personal mobility even more important.
Gogoro is known for its smart scooters and its award-winning battery-swapping technology, which removes the hassle of waiting for your ride to charge up. Gogoro currently has 5 swap-and-go stations in Metro Manila. It aims to put up 2 more by year-end and up to 30 more next year.
With battery swapping, it changed everything. You don't have to buy a battery. You don't need to worry about whether or not the battery is performant. If the battery gets old, you just swap another one, right? In Taiwan, people swap about 3 times a week, right, on average, letting the consumer basically not worry about the distance they can ride, not worry about the time they'll have to waste to charge the battery.
Not only is the process quicker than gassing up a regular vehicle, Gogoro Philippines President Bernie Liamzon says, it's also cheaper than having to routinely replace EV batteries.
The onus of taking care of the battery is on us. The other EVs that we know, you need to be able to replace the battery. And the cost of the battery in EVs is very expensive. That's easily close to 50% of the cost.
For its commercial launch next month, Gogoro Philippines will be putting its high-end scooters up for sale. It aims to bring in its mid-priced and entry-level scooters by the middle of 2024 to attract a wider market. It's also looking at prepaid battery swaps at its GO stations.
We are teaching Gogoro how to do prepaid the Philippine way and the emerging markets way. Sachet pricing, no commitment. Right? All built and paid for digitally via GCash.
But Liamzon hopes two-wheeled EVs would be included in the tariff exemption under the Electric Vehicle Industry Development Act so they can make their scooters more affordable.
So right now, we continue to be covered by the 30% tariff. We're working with the relevant government agencies so that we could also avail of the tariff holiday.
Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
And before we go, many companies have claimed that AI has significantly helped their operations, but one academy believes that technology could also revolutionize the healthcare sector. Let's find out how in this report.
In today's fast-evolving healthcare landscape, artificial intelligence is not just an innovation. It's also a force that is reshaping the nursing field in a profound way. Dr. Neil Gokal of the American Academy of Family Physicians says AI helps nurses care for their patients at an exponential level.
Nurses are being able to use technology to better understand pathology, medication, side effects, all of the things that they have for years and years dealt with their patients, but do this on a higher level to really impact outcomes, improve quality, and see better results with their patients.
Gokal adds that while AI has its limitations and acknowledges the essential role of human intervention, it is crucial to maintain an open mind on its use.
AI is definitely better and helpful to nurses and to healthcare professionals in general. And just like anything else, not everything is perfect. We have to take things in strides, certainly be open to that innovation and see how it fits within what we're trying to do and continue to look at outcomes and data.
Gokal spoke at a recent seminar organized by the Philippine Nurses Association of Nevada. The event sought to explore the use of AI in healthcare, both in terms of the opportunities that it presents and the challenges that it may pose.
A topic that means for the future. It's very, very significant because you have the PNA and the advanced practice nursing in one cohesive action looking at in the future, and that future is about artificial intelligence.
AI plays a big role in our nursing world. There's a lot of checks and balances that we need to do, and so AI utilizes that information so we are able to cross-check everything for our patients, making sure that ensuring quality of care is provided, making sure there's no mistakes. So that's really key into helping our practice.
The integration of AI into the healthcare system is seen by some as raising challenges, primarily from uncertainty over the reliability of its algorithms. But for many Filipino-American nurses in the Valley, AI has significantly improved care delivery by automating time-consuming, non-specialized nursing tasks. Nurses say it also enables them to direct their attention towards patient care. Bev Lorente, ABS-CBN News, Las Vegas.
And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Consentino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on our YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.